Okay. So you remember this was on the 27th, and this is the day we're really doing the chart for. And I want to emphasize this string of tornadoes here from north of Little Rock, northeastward. And this was the chart that I gave you from 24 hours earlier. Now this is the chart that I analyzed. That was the same one that was given to you. You can see the consolidated low, north central Kansas, dry line. I actually drew a couple of fronts in through here because there was a temperature drop off back here, and then these strong pressure rises. You can see this orange and these lower right numbers up in the 3.5, 4 range, indicative of large pressure rises. There was something coming down the high plains in through here. I also had this warm front, and I may have had it farther south than some of you folks had. Some of this northeast wind in northwest Indiana, I think that's where it is, no, northwest Illinois, Iowa, Mississippi, there were some thunderstorms up in that area, and I had this convective boundary in through here. But I had the warm front down here where you have southerly winds to the south of it, and then it switches more to an easterly component. But then it gets really complicated in the Tennessee Valley area and into some of the mid-south. And what I've got on here, let's zoom in. Okay, can you see that better? In through here, there's a lot of pressure rises, pressure fall areas, and there's a gradient. Remember that gradient I talked about that were on some of your charts? This was a convectively generated boundary that went from parts of Georgia through central Alabama up into northern Mississippi and then into parts of central Arkansas. And it's really in through here. If you take a look, El Dorado was 83, 64, Texarkana 77, 69 with more south wind. Little Rock, southeast wind, 74 degrees. So you see these winds with more of an easterly component, and here we have more southerly. So you have the thermal gradient, you also have the wind shift, and you have somewhat of a pressure trough in there. And it was this particular boundary here, if we go back and look at the storm reports in Arkansas, that we think played a key role in the thunderstorm development and the severe storms that occurred in this part of Arkansas from just north of the boundary northward. So you probably had increased convergence. If you have low-level mass convergence, what happens to that air where you have convergence? Well, it can either try and force its way through the ground into the Earth's core. That usually doesn't happen. So if it can't go down, which way is it going to go? It's going to go up. You're going to have parcels that are ascending, and you're probably, if it's unstable enough, you're going to have storms, thunderstorms. And in this particular case, you had severe thunderstorms that were producing tornadoes. So the analysis of this boundary here, across Arkansas and then back across northern Mississippi into central Alabama. I don't know if you can, how well you can see this. I'm going to hand out charts to you of this, but you see the warmer temperatures to the south, the cooler temperatures to the north, as identified in the thermal gradient, but you also have some convergence of the winds. And it was really this boundary here that we're talking about, plus the dry line, that was particularly important in focusing some of the severe weather on this particular day. So we went through the upper air charts last time, and you remember talking about a composite chart where we take features from different constant pressure levels and put them together on one map. Well, we can do something similar with this, because here's the surface map. We can take the 850 jet in red, the 500 millibar jet in blue, the dry intrusion at 700, and lo and behold, let's back it up, looks a little bit like this. Some hint of a pattern that will then be able to focus severe weather threat. And if we see, take a look at what happened, that's what happened over the 24-hour period. Much of that was during the afternoon into the evening hours. So by doing the chart analysis at different levels and then trying to combine it into a rather simplified three-dimensional picture, it can give us a better handle on where the threat might be for severe weather. And this is something that we continue to use along with all of the other multitude of model information, radar, satellite, workstations, et cetera. Sometimes it can still be very helpful to go back to the basics and pay attention to the observational data and try and figure out what it means. And I think that's the last slide I've got there. So I've got, at the end of the class today, I've got the composite chart as well as just the surface chart. If you guys want to take a copy and throw darts at it later, it's your choice. But I think that's something that we can talk about more if you are interested in this. But it is a long established part of operational severe weather forecasting, and it takes effort. This isn't easy. If it was easy, it could all be automated. If it was easy, people would have discovered all the solutions to forecasting severe weather a long time ago. But it's not. And that's one of the reasons that we are attracted to it, because in some ways we like to be challenged. We like to try and address things that are still challenging to do.